that sounding okay? Okay.
Caving has always been
yep.
great.
So you can...
Caving, you want to answer that question of what's around the next corner. That's like always the question you want to know. It's mostly fueled by curiosity. But as you get into caving more and more, scientific...
If you want to pause it for a second.
I want to know, how did these places form?
And we can start over. And I'll just give you a short preface to this. So, everyone, I'm Lindsay Eaves, and I was very fortunate to be a member of the Rising Star Expedition in the Cradle of Humankind that kicked off in November of last year. And this video is one of a number of short videos that National Geographic has up on their Explorers blog. So this is a National Geographic video. So I have no license on this. However, I like to show this because this gives you guys a little bit of a feel for what it's like to be in our cave. The two cavers that you will see prominently in this, Stephen Tucker and Rick Hunter, were actually the two recreational cavers who first discovered the fossils that we later began excavating in November of last year. And so this is Stephen giving his sort of take on things. It'll situate you a little bit what the cave's like and give you a little bit of an idea of the difference between caving and spelunking, the difference between just taking a flashlight and heading into a dark hole and what these guys do, which is a whole different kind of pursuit. So this is just a brief little video.
Caving has always been
this
great.
Is the start.
Caving, you want to answer that question of what's around the next corner. That's like always the question you want to know. It's mostly fueled by curiosity. But as you get into caving more and more, the scientific side of it comes into it. You want to know, how did these places form? What happened here millions of years ago? What happened here billions of years ago? Basically, it creates a fascination with this whole environment. In my wildest dreams, I would never have thought that caving would take me to what's happening here. You could almost call this a bit of an accident. So my caving buddy and me, Rick, we were out exploring this cave on a Friday night. We'd gone to a very remote section of the cave, part that I'd never been in before. And in that section, well, we stumbled upon fossils. Yeah, at first we didn't exactly know what fossils yet. We started looking around a bit more until we found a mandible, and that was when we knew this was probably a hominid. That was when we got excited about it. And since this discovery, it's crazy what's happening here. Pedro Bossoff is a geologist. He's been caving in this country for 30 plus years, and he was asked by Lee to basically go and look for fossils in deeper areas of caves. And he'd then spoken to myself and Rick and a few others and said, oh, he needs us to come start looking for hominids. And on this whole expedition, he has been in charge of the cavers, coordinating who is here and what we have to do and getting everything organized for us. Since the start of this expedition, from the caver's side, we've been putting in over 2 kilometers of cabling. Those are for cameras, lights, communications within the cave. We've also put up safety ropes straight throughout the cave for the safety of the scientists, making sure there's no injuries. And we're here for backup, that in case something does go wrong, we are here to assist as soon as possible.
Okay. There we go.
So here's your...
My magic wand.
Wand.
Perfect. Okay. I will draw a little bit of attention here. This is me down in the fossil chamber. So one of the things that you probably noticed in looking at the video, as they were discussing the cameras and the wiring and cabling that's gone on, this is not science as usual. We had to really definitely tell the cavers that they have no other experience of what an expedition's like, that this is not normally how things work in our science. And so as I'm talking about the expedition, one of the things that we're very adamant about is sort of a transparency in our data collection process and how we do science, but we do also have to sort of stress that this is not normally how science, particularly in our field, is done. There's a lot of things that are quite high tech, which we're very fortunate to work with, enormous amount of publicity surrounding the Australopithecus sediba discovery that our expedition leader, Lee Berger, was part of. And a lot of that has actually helped to smooth this process along. This photograph here shows me monitoring the Artec scanner. So we have another one of the excavators who is using a 3D white light strobe scanner. And I'm monitoring to make sure that she has full coverage of the area and that the distance is proper for the aperture here. But this is quite early on in the expedition, actually, because you'll see that I'm still wearing boots. We very quickly switched to a barefoot protocol because there are bones everywhere. So this photograph was actually taken by one of the excavators, the advanced scientist, Ellen Farragel, and she actually won a field project photography contest for the Australian Association of Anthropologists with us. Okay, so some background to the Rising Star expedition. You can see this is the full group just starting out. This is towards the beginning. You'll see that I'm one of the few people that I never ever could remember to turn my light off. Once you get out of the cave, you don't see your light anymore. So this is early on. This is Stephen, and this is Rick, and there's Pedro back here. We have some of our other cavers, and then these are the six underground scientists and Lee. And pretty much every aspect of this expedition was not quite business as usual. So this is a joint exploration by the University of the Witwatersrand, affectionately known as WITS, and the National Geographic Society. This is located in the Cradle of Humankind. So the Cradle of Humankind, we're actually quite lucky for this, is already designated by the South African government as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. So this whole area of caves in which we're working, which is near a number of very prominent early hominid sites, has all been protected, which was very fortunate for us because what we're finding is that the entire system of caves is potentially just filthy with fossil hominids. This is located about 31 miles northwest of Johannesburg, and it's about 180 square miles. So while the rest of the area of South Africa, so here you can see the area surrounding here, some big places that we're near are Sterkfontein, Swartkrans, and Kromdraai. We're quite near to Sterkfontein, actually. That we have about 180 square miles of land that's sort of parceled off as safe at this time. Although we have little doubt that probably as the areas are continuing to be explored, that the number of caves, fossiliferous caves, is going to just continue to increase. One of the things that Lee said about the Rising Star system itself, the Rising Star cave system, could be also true of the entirety of this karstic area in South Africa, which is that once you start to examine an area, it becomes abundant. That basically the only reason that we haven't seen these before is we just weren't looking. They're just literally everywhere. So there's more than 36 fossil-bearing caves. Stay tuned for an updated count, because as this is just one of the first finds that they had found, and this is the first place that we're working. So the fossils are often in these areas encased in a mixture of limestone and other sediments, known as breccia. This actually, Littlefoot has just recently been in the news. They had a redating of Littlefoot. I think they're putting it now at about 3 million years, so making it older than they had previously thought. This is Ron Clark, and this is the hard sediment that you're working with in a lot of cases. A lot of the history of early finds in South Africa is related to the mining history. There's a lot of the finds. In fact, the first fossil hominin that was found in Africa, the Tong child, was actually discovered as a result of quarrying activity. So I have these casts that you guys are free to look at towards the end. But this is just messy, terrible stuff to work with. You can see here, he's essentially working with a dental drill. And we were, in fact, lucky enough that the material that we were working in was a sort of soft clay sediment. And so we were actually excavating using toothpicks. So nice synchrony. So here we have this very complete partial skeleton, Littlefoot here. So that's an Australopithecus africanus. So these are our commanders in chief. I like to show these pictures just because these aren't the pictures that you'd get in other places of them. So this is so Dr. Lee Berger, and this is Dr. John Hawks with his trademark fedora. John Hawks is in Wisconsin, and he has a paleoanthropology blog that I would urge you all to check out. It's really fantastic information. And Lee is our National Geographic Explorer in residence, and he's the head of our expedition. This is Rick back here. Becca actually had her birthday during Rising Star, and so we, of course, had to celebrate. So these are advanced cave scientists, and the way that they have us sort of staggered here is you really can't quite appreciate just how small Becca is. When Rick told me that when they saw Becca, when he first saw Becca, he ran to the other cave and said, "We're in trouble. She's going to outcave us. She's just so tiny." So this is Becca Pashitam. Here we have Aliyah Gertov, Ellen Farragel. Ellen is actually from Australia. Marina Elliott, who's from Canada. That's me. And then Hannah Morris. And the way that we were chosen for the expedition is we have an overlapping set of skills and personalities such that working in teams, we're able to sort of fill out the gaps where one person might have in their knowledge with another person's expertise. So it was actually a very, very cool team to work with, and we all learned quite a bit from it. We're supposed to be striking a astronaut pose there. That's actually one of the things that you'll hear a lot in caving, is that it is very much like being on the moon. You're, for how far away you are from other people. A sprained ankle down in a cave can very easily be a 19-hour undertaking to get someone back out, depending on how wedged you are in there. So small problems can quickly escalate and be very large. The reason that we had all the cabling and all of the cameras and so forth is that the cave was fully equipped because our commander-in-chief will never, ever go down to the fossil chamber. He cannot fit. He is too big to fit down into the fossil chamber. And so we have a situation where the higher up are in the uncomfortable position of having to take a back seat. Of course, because of this, we then end up having no fewer than 3 cameras on us as we're excavating at all times. Talk about nerve-wracking. You're working with some of the most delicate and potentially very significant fossils, and you're being watched by your boss at all times. It's like a security camera. You know, there's no getting around that. But that's to Lee's credit, I would say, is that he will never be down there. And he could very easily have blasted a hole through here. This is very common, that another entrance will be made and that so that people can get down and there can be more access. And his argument was, why would I destroy the cave to suit my own ego? There are people that can get down there. I'm just not one of them. And he's satisfied with that. So the incredible lack of ego throughout the entire Rising Star expedition has been really incredible. So these are some of our cavers. And to give you an idea of how this goes about, so this is someone who does fit down the chute. So that's Rick. That's give you an idea. That is Gumby personified there. Here we have some of the other cavers, not on this expedition, but one of the cavers that came to be known, or is affectionately known with his friends, as the Plug. This is Harry, and Harry's not wearing his pants anymore. That's because this is how tight it is in these situations, is that your clothes will literally be stripped off your body. As that was our first actual introduction to Harry, was seeing how well all of the cameras were working, is we have an area of the cave that's known as the post box, and it's known as the post box. It's actually apparently called the Superman crawl by other capers, but we renamed it the post box, but because it's a very small sort of slit horizontal opening. And it's called the Superman crawl because you literally have to put one arm ahead and the other arm back in order to get through, and you just sort of wave kick your feet, sort of like you're doing a butterfly stroke. And we happened to be talking in the command center, and I looked over at one of the cameras, and there was a full moon. Because that's one of the key points. We want to have one camera on either side of the post box. We didn't mean for it to be a peep show, but whenever someone large would go down there, we'd all sort of hope that it would be entertaining. And poor Harry, this is right at the very beginning, he didn't realize that he knew there was a camera. He wasn't quite sure where it was, because you could see he backed out, and I yelped as I saw this come on the screen. We're all crowded around the screen going, who is that? And then we see him turn around and doing one of these. And putting his jumper back on as it had gotten stripped off him. He wore bike shorts after that. So the adventure unfolds. This is one of our fossil vaults. We ended up having, I believe, three of them. They had to keep ordering more. We had to just keep getting more boxes. We completely emptied the entirety of the cradle area of all their Tupperware and all of their plastic bags. They're actually having to build a larger vault at VITS to accommodate all the fossils that we have. And this is the disembodied head of our fair leader. We actually found that when we were down in the cave, we had a intercom that worked so that there wasn't an open line. We would have to wave to get the attention on like a camera, and then Lee would pick up a comm line and talk to us, and we would just sort of talk into the air. Sort of, we called it the God mic. And so we'd have Lee's voice just, you know, flooding the fossil chamber. But we found that if we wave and stuff, that for some reason no one would ever notice. But if we had the disembodied head of Lee waving back at him, it's like that monkey recognition factor. That's like, yeah, that's me, and then he'd always pick up. So, but they also had that laminated and put down there with the idea. We took a picture of it for him that, see, Lee was down in the fossil chamber. So recreational cavers, Stephen Tucker and Rick Hunter, stumbled upon these fossils in the beginning of October. And to give you an idea of how quickly this had happened, Pedro had, the geologist, had been tasked with putting together some people and starting to really push these caves. When they say push a cave, that means get into all the hidden away parts, get into all the nooks and crannies. So not just the parts that are easy to get into, but really the out of way places is what they call pushing cave. To give you an idea of this, Stephen had said to me, he was trying to explain to one of the journalists what caving was, and it's like, it's all mental. And his girlfriend very quickly piped up, yeah, you're all mental. To give you an idea of what pushing a cave system can look like, Rick actually broke his clavicle, his collarbone, just a few weeks ago while caving, in a squeeze. He didn't fall. He just pushed himself through a slot that was even too small for him and broke it. That's par for the course for them. So this moved very, very rapidly. Actually, I'm going to, so that you're not trying to read this, I'll go back for 1 second. To give you an idea of just how quickly this went out, right at the very beginning of October, they find this, they go back with the camera, they take the pictures, they show Lee. Lee's immediately starts a flurry of phone calls and emails, and Lee sends his son Matt down to take a look and to sort of evaluate the situation. How many people are familiar with Australopithecus sediba? Followed that find at all? Maybe a few. In 2008, his then, I believe, 9-year-old son Matt actually had found first fossil, this clavicle of this. And so growing up in this family, Matt's not your average 15-year-old. And so he sends his son, Matt, down to take a look. And when Matt came back up, he went to Lee, and Lee said, the first thing he said was, Daddy? And he's 15. He does not call him Daddy anymore. He was just so overcome by what he had seen, and he knew that this was really, really big. And so from there, it moved really quickly. There were a couple hundred photographs of the bones that were taken. And on the basis, on the strength of that, two cavers, his teenage son, and IDs from these photographs with scales, Lee made the decision that he was going to move on this fast. And so he called National Geographic and his site of Malapa, which is nearby in the Cradle area, which he had gained a lot of money and a lot of fame and notoriety for this Australopithecus sediba find. And they had a there was 11 articles in Science and over a number of years. On the strength of this and his new explorer in residence standing as part of the society, they moved the money from Malapa over to the Rising Star Cave system, just like that. And it was so fast that by October 9th, this is what I was reading on my Facebook. Lee did something really unconventional, because that's just Lee. And he sent out a call on social media, on Twitter, on Facebook, on LinkedIn, and I forever am going to use this as my carte blanche to be like, I told you so, I told you that my Facebook and Twitter addiction is not, is not just trivial. I'm doing something there. So I see this. And the basis of this is that they needed to start off very, very quickly. So they wanted to kick off at the beginning of November. This is incredibly fast turnaround for an expedition. Usually there's a whole process of grants and logistics, and they just jumped. So first you needed to be available. They were looking for skinny scientists, preferably small. They also had such things as must not be claustrophobic, must be fit, some caving experience, climbing experience would be a bonus, they must have a good attitude, be a team player. They were looking for an experienced PhD student or perhaps early career scientist. And they needed to have them contact directly, copied to his assistant, Wilma. Well, over the weekend, Wilma comes back to a flurry of emails from a lot of women who are saying, hey, I saw your ad on Facebook, and I'm available. I have a really good personality, and these are my measurements. And she went, Lee, what have you done? And embarrassingly, we sort of all looked around, and we're all like, yep, we all sent in our measurements. You know. The next information that came out for this also said must not be epileptic. So by this point, most sane people are going, what? And we're like, must not be claustrophobic, must not be epileptic, must be really skinny and small. This sounds awesome. This sounds like something that we definitely want to do. It reminds me of sort of the Shackleton ad for men looking for adventure, risk of death. Yeah.
But his name and an affiliation were attached to this, so you had some idea.
Oh yeah. Well, yeah. No, we all knew who Lee was, and so we were all hoping this has got to be something. This is, you knew it was big because of how quickly they moved on it. We all knew it had to be big because of that, but we couldn't imagine what the circumstances were. These are some of those early photographs that launched as the face that launched the thousand ships, that launched the six underground astronauts. And you can see some recognizable material here. And this also gives you an idea of a lot of the material. There was a lot of material that was just lying about on the floor of the fossil chamber, that it's like a King Tut's tomb. What do you see? Wonderful things, right? As you walk through there, you're seeing bones everywhere.
Are the squares centimeters?
Yes. And here we have, we have a portion of a mandible, a portion of a femur here. This is Petrus portion. This is the external auditory meatus. So you see your little ear hole there. This is of portion of the cranium. This is within the puzzle box area that we were mainly working on. So called because it was just a puzzle of bones. They were just massed all on top of one another. It was like playing Jenga, only with priceless fossils. You can see wear on the teeth there. And we get on site, and we're in the middle of a horse pasture. And we're told, we've flown you in from all over the world to work on these priceless fossils. Start putting camp together. So we immediately were put to work. So this is the entrance, the main entrance to the cave. I should note that the Rising Star cave system does have a number of different openings. It does also hook up with another portion of a cave system that's known as Westminster. And so there's numerous ways in there. However, where the chute is, we're not clear exactly. There's really, the fossil chamber only has one very clear entrance to it. You can get to part of the area from numerous ways, but that's pretty localized. So this is our home sweet camp. So we had a little bit of a media circus to begin with. We were actually filmed by National Geographic, the entirety of the expedition. We had a National Geographic blogger, Andrew Halley, with us the entire time, who was sort of like embedded with us. That was kind of cool. We also had, they had moved these over from a documentary that they were doing on the Malapa, on the Sidiba work, but quickly this became sort of a thing on itself. We had a lot of media attention surrounding this, which is not normal. And here's our campfire. Days began at about 5:30 in the morning when we were literally cooked out of our army tents. So this gives you an idea of the area here. And this is a little house up in the hill. The people that live there, they're actually one of the I believe it was the tourism minister of the area. He came by to see us, and when he did, he looked at their house, and he was talking with Lee, and he came to an immediate decision upon looking at the area that they wanted to invest in moving the house to the bottom of the hill, and that what we're told is that that family will be trained as security for the site, and that they're going to have a modern house with modern plumbing and electricity paid in perpetuity by the University of the Witwatersrand. So it's a really cool, positive impact for local people. This is our caver's tent. We had these signs, and I believe there was exactly one day that it looked nice like that, because those signs did not want to behave. This is our command center. And this is the first view of the reconstruction of the fossil chamber floor and the puzzle box. So essentially what we're doing is, since we had a very fast excavation that we worked in 3 weeks, and we recovered over 1,200 fossil specimens, we're working extraordinarily rapidly. That normally the pace is not going to be quite that fast. One of the things that enabled us to work that quickly was we were using an Artec 3D white light strobe scanner, which is why we couldn't be epileptic. And we were 3D scanning the area that we're working in. And we would have fixed points or pins that would serve as a reference point. And we would scan periodically before we started excavating, then we would excavate, we would re-scan. Before we removed items, we would then document it using a forensic camera, which had a microscope setting on that with a scale. Then we would remove the items, bag them, identify them if we could, and package those to go up, and then re-scan the floor. Essentially what this allows us to do is, in the future, we're going to be able to redig the entirety of the site from any direction so that we have very high fidelity as to the positioning of all of the fossils, as well as the relative depths. And this is something that is very laborious work and mapping that just wasn't going to be feasible in the fossil chamber. It just wasn't feasible to really have pits plotted in the same way that you might in a normal archaeological setting. Plus, taking a page out of a fellow explorer residence, James Cameron's playbook, if you have science fiction level technology that is available to you, why not use it? And this actually was not as expensive a scanner as you would have thought, and the technology is coming down. Lee was saying that probably in the next couple of years, you'll probably be able to do this on your iPhone. So this is the reconstruction. We all gathered. So here's Ashley's head, here's Ashley's head here, here's me. And this was essentially our first real view of what the bones look like coming up. And I very predictably started bawling. And so I was known as the crier of the group. This gives you real fast parts of the Rising Star cave system. And I was very relieved to hear that Rising Star was the name of the cave system, because when they told us that this was the Rising Star Expedition and that we're going to be filmed for a documentary for National Geographic, I went, oh gosh, please don't be so cheesy. That sounds horrible. I was like, oh, that's the, okay. But I wasn't the only person who thought that. We were very pleased. Apparently the the formations in a different portion of the cave. I've given it that name. We have the post box of the Superman crawl, which I had described to you. We have an area that then, so those are two parts of the cameras, one on either end of the post box. Then we go up what's known as the dragon's back, which is, it looks sort of like going along the ridge of like a dinosaur or a dragon, if you were going just along the plates that are rising vertically. From it. So there's a little section that we climb up there, and looks, for all the world, I mean, I feel like you're in Lord of the Rings. And once the portion of the dragon's back had actually, they believe, been part of the ceiling that had fallen. Then we have our base one, which is where I'm sitting right here. This is looking down into the chute. You'll see ropes that are going down there. We don't actually use those ropes for climbing. Those were for hauling the fossils up. You free climb down it, which is really more like controlled serial falling, is you just, there's only one direction to go. So you just sort of hop down until you feel more ledge. At the top, we have an intercom, or we call them, let them know we're going down the chute, and they'll give us clearance to descend. And then once we reach the bottom of the chute, the bottom base, this is a 18 centimeter at the a narrowest gap, which was erroneously reported in some media as an 18 centimeter bust. So very helpfully, of course, everyone that you know then starts to email you to let you know that they know that you don't have an 18 centimeter bust. It's like, no one does, no adult does. Then we have a fossil chamber that we're working in. We have one main area that we were excavating on that was, as I said, the puzzle box, and then a nearby area that we had a little bit of a grid system set up for that was very, very loose, and we're calling the pin four tooth fairy hoard because it was basically just teeth. There were just teeth, 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 lots and lots of loose teeth. This gives you a view of our Brady Bunch camera. So this is sort of as they're watching us make our progress through, and they would watch us as we progressed in and out of the cave system, so that we were always supervised in some way. We did have one close call towards the middle of the expedition. Once people started to get a little bit more comfortable with things, and it was getting very humid down there. It's the rainy season, and we're also breathing, so it's getting quite humid down there. Things are getting more slick. We did have one of the scientists fell as she was going back up the chute. Coming down the chute is very easy. Coming out of the chute was actually the most terrifying experience for me, because you can't actually climb. You're so close that you can't draw your legs up. There's no possible way to climb out. And so instead, what you're doing is you're relying on a lot of upper body strength to just sort of push yourself and sort of pop up. And then as you can, chimney. So pushing your back for friction, sort of scooch yourself back up. And I was terrified that first day. I was like, I'm going to die here. I'm never, ever going to get out of here again. This is just dead. I'm just going to stay here. It was very exhausting at the beginning. But it had a slip where one moment she was going up, and the next minute she's coming back down at high velocity. I was actually below her at the time. She fell about 3 feet, where she was stopped by her shin, and a rock. And we did actually have to do some triage, a little bit of triage down in the cave itself, because you don't want to go back up with an open wound. But they sent Rick in with medical supplies, and it took him 4 minutes to make it through the entire system there. where we were making the commute in like 20 minutes. This is actually the area that we're sort of working in. Here is middle portion, I'm told, because I can't read cave maps. They look like Rorschach tests, inkblot tests to me. Here is the entrance onto the cave. You can see the cabling there. Here I'm doing the rocky stance coming out. And I will say, people standing around, we had sort of a situation where people would, there was always someone who was waiting to pat you on the back as you were coming out, and Lee would give you a big hug. This is the post box. You saw how small Rick is? So that's quite tight. Just gives you some more views. This is the dragon's back here. And this is the fossil chamber. And the puzzle box area is under this overhang. And just ending it here, so if you have any questions, this is the site that we're working in. This is UW-101. And in the last days of the site, this is the minister coming out, who said the nation must know what is going on here. It gave me chills, because he also did it in his cool South African accent. After our excavating for 7 to 8 hours a day, 101 led to another site, which was, I'm coming to here. Oh, this is something that we were doing as Skyping classrooms. We did this several times during the excavation. That was a really cool aspect, to talk to kids while we were actually on site. Because in our evening, it was their daytime. This became very quickly, in 3 weeks, the most abundant fossil hominid site in southern Africa. Over 1,200 fossils excavated in 3 weeks. And as I've been telling people, you can very easily take one bone and you can make 1,200 specimens, but these are ones that, and that's what you have in a lot of cases at these early sites, but what we have is, any of you with no anatomical knowledge, if I give you a picture of the bones and you take a look at them, you'd all be able to identify them. They're very, very readily recognizable. We have some very, very rare bones that are represented. We have at least 11 individuals. A range of sexes is represented, and of ages is the whole gamut. There's trans sexes there. We run the gamut from male to female. We have a range of ages represented. So we have adults, and we have juveniles. We have males, we have females. So this is very significant because it hopefully will give us some idea about ranges of variation within a population, which is something that you don't often get. Socially, this has been significant because of the open access, the transparency of the expedition, and there's a workshop for early career scientists that is being offered in May. That was another call out on social media that is giving people who normally get the dregs of science and do a lot of the grunt work for their professors. Lee is very, very, very awesomely and very consciously elevated those people that need a boost, who need something like this to get their careers started. And they'll be working on analyzing and describing the fossils, and we're looking for as rapid publication as we're able doing the science. So also we're looking at doing citizen science, so allowing lay people to also look at some of the information in the future and possibly help us. We're doing a lot of education outreach. That's why I'm here. We have a lot of cross-cultural exchange and socioeconomic factors. Very consciously being built into the program, so moving forward, it will positively impact the people that live in the area of the cradle, many of whom have no idea that there's fossil humans there, despite the fact that they live in the cradle of humankind. So the return, they're looking at 2 month stints for this year and beyond, training other people as cavers, workshop in May for collaboration. And our postscript is the last day they found in another part of the rising star system some more fossils. So these are the ones that they're in this little Tupperware here. We call them the glove box fossils because they brought them back. This is Lee's house. That's his son, Matt. John Hawks drove those back in his rental car with fossils in the glove box to show to Lee. He had not found that his car, apparently, he had not had the paperwork go through with the rental agency, and so it was past the point. So he's ostensibly in a stolen vehicle, and we got stopped at a police, a routine police stop. And so poor John's sweating bullets because he has, you know, human bones in the glove box and a stolen car. That turned out just fine. So this is the next part. So in February, Lee and Rick went down with Aaliyah to excavate. Aaliyah and Ali excavated from an area that has, it looks like, one individual. Still not sure how complete, but we're very hopeful. And you'll see in this next picture, people ask, why is Aaliyah so clean and why are you so dirty? And Lee's response was simply, she fits. He got stuck coming back out for 45 minutes. Actually necessitated Rick to find another way in and under him and then push him back out. I'm just like picturing like Winnie the Pooh. So that's another part that is just within this one cave system. So National Geographic Society, we got a sign, a flag. That was super cool moment. Any questions? Yes?
What were the estimated ages of the fossils?
Dates for the fossils?
Yeah.
They just had a geologist just go out there like yesterday, the day before. So we still haven't had any sort of real hard estimates. And the way that these are typically dated is you don't date the fossils themselves as you date the surrounding matrix. Well, these we're not sure. Before we know the geology of the cave a little bit better, since these were in loose sediment, we're not sure, and we know that there has been an earthquake at some point in the past. We need to piece together what belongs with the fossils. They've placed it, though, within a time that is bracketed. They think the caves themselves are in the sort of 2 to 1 million year range. So obviously they didn't get there before the caves were formed. That's a very, very broad swath of time. And there's a lot of different fossil hominid taxa that are potentially represented at that time period. So that was a time when there were a number of different humans and human-like animals that were all in the same landscape. And it does bridge a time that you have both humans and human-like. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Yes.
What is a hyoid bone and why are they rare in bone?
Okay. hyoid is, if any of you watch crime shows, sort of it's a horseshoe-shaped bone that is placed, it's over roughly where your larynx is. And it has three parts. It has a sort of like a body that's a little bit, it's like a tiny little button. And then it has two very, very delicate little horns that come off it. And in manual strangulation cases, like it's broken. Like you can just crush it. Just with too much pressure. So it's a very small bone, is one thing. It's a very fragile bone. And it looks, sometimes they can look like rocks or pebbles. So there's a number of different factors, but we only have two of them known in human evolution.
It doesn't articulate with any other
bone. Yeah, it doesn't. Yeah, it doesn't articulate with. It's sort of it's related to a lot of soft tissue structures, but it's very important because of its sort of articulation, like with the tongue. And so, like, there's a lot of work that's done with the hyoid in speech capacity. So it's related to a number of structures, like the larynx, but also to the tongue. And so those are the main points of interest, is that the shape of the hyoid is different in different primates. Like, for instance, if you see howler monkeys and so forth, they'll have like pneumatized, inflated bodies for resonance. So yeah, it's a very small, very fragile bone. And so typically, before you have intentional interment or burial, you're not getting quite so many bones. So one of them that's known is a Neanderthal one from Kibara in Israel. And then the other is actually an Australopithecus afarensis, known as Dakika or Lucy's baby. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Introduce your friends.
Yes. Okay. So I have brought with me. So this is actually, so this is Australopithecus sediba. There's two main skeletons and then an isolated adult tibia that's known for the Malapa materials. This is, so these are casts. And the way that I like to explain these is people very quickly notice that they have different colors. And the way that I explain casts is such that the white point, white part here is a hypothesis. This is what we think the rest is based on you know, the shape of the other bones, what we know of allometry and sizing. And in a lot of cases, what we know from other individuals, we can sort of reconstruct that. So for instance, when you see you know, something like this and you go, that looks like a lot of guesswork. that remember that a lot of this is having to do with the shape of the bones themselves, and so they're going to tell you you know, something about how they fit. These are all, these are australopithecines. So this is Australopithecus sediba. This is an Australopithecus africanus. This is a juvenile. This is Tong, the Tong child. And so this is not, when it was first found, was actually not recognized as being, you know, human. It came at a time when the popular, the scientific community had different ideas as to what the earliest members of our lineage would look like, and this just did not fit that at all. And so Raymond Dart, the anatomist who studied and described this, had actually quite a lot of hard work ahead of him. And I believe that we actually have a person here, Lydia, who has just written on Tong, so could probably
tell you more about that, so you can swap her afterwards too. So that way, I will make my getaway. It looks a lot like a chimp. It looks a lot like a neonate, like a young chimpanzee. And actually, when you look at the anatomy of chimpanzee, infant chimps, they do look a lot more human-like. They have sort of a globe look to their forehead. And in fact, that's actually, there's people that have argued that humans, that we actually have a sort of a neotenous features. That is, that we look like, we're a throwback to, we look like babies. We're like grown-up babies, essentially. And a lot of our features with the positioning of our eyes and forehead and so forth. This is also...
The teeth are here, they're brown, like some of the other pieces. So, I mean, so are those...
This is all true. This was all found. This portion of the palate. And one of the things that you will notice about this is that as we're looking at... you look at our dental arcade versus some of the earlier dental arcades, and you can see they're sort of more intermediary. So you can see this is a chimpanzee, you can see a number of things. You'll see that the chimpanzee has a more rectangular dental arcade to the hard palate. You can see a little bit more rectangular in this Australopithecus specimen, and then we have more of a rounded or a parabolic. You can also see in the chimpanzee, we've got some wicked canines on there, and you can also see that the canines are a bit more pronounced still in the Australopithecines, that was not something that's used so much for eating, but more indicative of sexual dimorphism, and it indicates a more polygamous or hareming grouping. So it's used for display. Yes.
You mentioned that you found a pile of teeth in one location.
Yeah, it's.
What initial hypothesis did you and your colleagues come up with?
When you find something like that, no, it's not just a pile of teeth. This is like in a lot of sediment. So there's isolated teeth just everywhere in there. We're still trying to figure out what the site formation of 101 is, and then bam, now we got 102. Okay, we'll deal with that in a second. So the first site that we were excavating, we're still trying to, we've had people, wildly speculating, there does appear to be size sorting of some kind.
Of
all of the elements. So heavier elements not are closer to the entrance, the area. And the lighter ones, possibly. We're not sure whether that would have been the original origin of that was the origin of the site, but that might be how they came to be together in this area. So we did also find that as we were working in the puzzle box, to give you an idea, it's sort of like working in a little room. There's a slot, and then you sort of have a gradual hill that has like a couple of landing areas. And so we're sort of, we would have one of the cavers sitting at the bottom of the chute, and they would be bored out of their brains. And they would start doing what cavers do, which is they just start, oh, there's a hole. They'd start climbing another thing. And we'd have them go, hey guys, is this anything? And we'd be like, no, first we were just like, yeah, no, you guys are big shots, you find bones. Now you think you find bones everywhere. Oh my God. Rick said he's never been hit by so many happy scientists ever before, because we would predictably come over and be like, stop it, stop moving, don't touch anything, just stay put, please. We can't deal with it anymore right now. Yeah, so we don't think that they were, that I call it the Tooth Fairy Horde, because there was a Family Guy episode where Tooth Fairy has a big pile and then does like the Scrooge McDuck, just like lolling in the teeth. That's what it made me think of. So it's not, scientists are goofy too. We had a lot of that. A favorite comic of mine is Invader Zim, and I don't know if anyone knows it, but it has a stupid robot in there, and Aaliyah also knows the same one. So one time I asked her, you know, what the bone was, and she goes, I don't know, which is a perfect mimic of this robot's voice, and I just lost it. Yes.
So there's
Earl just like, yes, and then you guys.
There's not a great theory for how these bones got in there, but there are other parts of this system where it was a complete individual?
We're not sure how complete that is, but it appears to be more in situ than what we have here. This doesn't appear to be in situ, so because you have so many individuals that are just like jumbled up upon one another. But also keep in mind, this is this is March. We didn't even know these existed in before the beginning of October. So this has been moving rather rapidly. And the thing that I try to impress upon a lot of people is that, yeah, we do have a lot of ideas. And we're working through a lot of those, but unfortunately, it's not CSI. And so, you know, a montage in music, science doesn't just suddenly happen. It's not quite that fast.
So any non-hominin remains among these things?
We found few rodent incisors, and we found a couple of bird bones that were not of the same age. But what we're finding is hominid. So that's puzzling. Yes?
So by fossils, everything's been completely replaced by other minerals.
These are, we're still waiting to hear to what degree these have been fossilized, because there's been the degree of the calcium in these. There's actually the calcite that would fall from the ceiling. We were having a hard time as we're digging. The calcite would leave the same sort of like chalky smears as the bones would. And so they're very, very similar, actually, in consistency, is that some of the bones were a lot more hardened, and some of them are more like, almost like sort of wet chalk, where like when it dries, it's harder, but it's very delicate in a sort of powdery way. And unfortunately, sometimes in situations like that, as they're drying, the bones will just spontaneously, more or less, just explode. They'll just, you open up a box and you're like, oh, well, great, now that's powder. That's super. Good thing we've got a lot of them. And the cavers keep saying, everyone tells us that, you know, fossil hominids are so rare. That really just doesn't seem to be my experience. Like, yeah, really cute.
What species?
We're not sure because we don't know the date, and because you do have the that will be part of this workshop, is doing the description, because you want to exhaustively compare it to everything. And what we're looking at is, since we do have a range of ages, we want to make sure that we're not just seeing something that is variation that just exists within a population, and saying, hey, there's a new species, just because we're like, I'm not sure about that, because in a lot of cases, you're working with so few individuals, and the range of variation in body types in this room alone is something that we don't have that luxury in paleoanthropology, and so you want to be cautious and.
Can you rule out any of them?
Well, it does not appear to be a robust australopithecine form. Unfortunately, I don't have a cast of a robust australopithecine, but the robust australopithecines that existed around the same time, these would be known as gracile forms, so that is, they're more lightly built. The robust forms, they actually have a sagittal crest, they have very heavy jaws, and they the morphology looks a lot more like a gorilla, and that's because their diet had a lot of hard items that they were eating, and so they have a hypertrophy of the masseter muscle for chewing, and then also the temporalis muscle. So like if you put your hand on the side of your head, you can feel it. And when muscle hypertrophies, it needs a place obviously to attach. And there's nothing there. So what it does is it just stimulates the bone to grow. It's sort of like, give me something to glom onto. And so what you end up having is sort of this more or less bony mohawk that grows. And that's where the muscle, it's like, I can't grow that way, I'm just gonna grow up that way. And so we don't believe that, although that was what we originally thought. We were told that we were being brought on to excavate one robust australopithecine skeleton, and so Lee told us that we did not finish the job that we came there to do, which was, now we have so many more. Yes?
What institutions were everyone from?
Let's see. I'm not even going to try to recount those because I know I will absolutely screw all of those up. I believe most of us are I think about like four of us are more PhD track or PhD candidate, I know Hannah and I think Becca as well are more professional archaeologists which you can stop at a master's. unfortunately, in a lot of in paleoanthropology, there's just nothing you can do with a master's. But they work more in archaeology. Hannah sort of runs a site down, and I believe it's North Carolina, but she actually is more of a, she is a plants person. A lot of the skills that we all had overlap very, very nicely. I actually previously did not have a ton of excavation experience. When I go to the field, I go to far off places, really cool, awesome places. I've been like on five different continents studying for and collecting my dissertation materials. I go to these really awesome places, and then I sit in a lab, or a museum, and I don't get to see it. So, huddled over a digitizer, and measuring the bones. But my strength is I'm also a anatomist, and so I worked for a time as a prosector. If any of you guys have seen those body exhibits, the body worlds, you've seen these. That is a process of dry embalming known as postination. And the University of Iowa that I was at when I was doing this has a small plastination lab. So I was a prosector, so what I would do is I would dissect for demonstration purposes, which is extremely detailed. It's actually, in a lot of ways, it prepared me very, very well for the kind of excavation that we were working with because of the level of blunt detail. When you're injecting something with veins with latex, you can't use anything sharp because you have one little nick and suddenly you're gonna have a blowout in your whole veins and you're gonna end up with latex everywhere. So it was a sort of a roundabout way to having my my excavation. I excavate in people. And also teach first year medical students, who are not geniuses, by the way.
Out of curiosity, any of the bones that were found in the cave have any kind of evidence of scoring, like consistent with like a predatory layer or something like that?
One of the things that we look at is the taphonomy, which is a burial science. So that's everything that that's sort of, I erroneously call it the life history of death, that it's sort of everything that happens around the time that you die up until whatever point you're looking at it. And all of that's gonna leave, you know, marks on things. And so that would fall under the taphonomy, would be, you know, was there a perimortem injury? Was there, you know, did something happen around the time of death? And there's certainly a lot of the site accumulation in South Africa is related to predation, and you'll see the punctures from leopards. I did not observe any of that, and we did not. There did not appear to be any sort of animal alteration of those. Now, that's on the site, so that's in the field, so that's quick and dirty. They've since been working on those microscopes, and so I'm not sure what they may have found now, but there is no obvious trauma. Also, it didn't seem as though they had been, there's no obvious injuries to them either. So we're looking for all different mechanisms of alteration to the bone, anything that happened after death. Hang on, you get to go home with me. So was there someone over here? It could also have been aliens. Yes, I'll come back to that, yes.
How did the bones get to where they were found?
We're not sure. That's a site formation process that we're still working through. So as we understand the site better, that gives us a better idea of how the materials within the site. So. Having the geologist come out there is very valuable because since we do know that sometime in the past, at least, there was a catastrophic earthquake that toppled the dragon's back from the ceiling down, we need to figure out what parts of the cave have always been in this orientation and which have shifted, where there's been collapses, whether or not there's openings that are now closed, because all of that is going to impact it. But as I said, with the laser scanning, one thing that's really fantastic about that is that that gives us the orientation of the bones and the depths, and so that allows us to have an idea of how they came to be there. This doesn't seem to be, they don't seem to be in situ, so this doesn't seem to be where they originally, this isn't where they fell. or they come from somewhere else, is what our feeling is. Yes, back there.
Essentially, that was going to be my question as well. The tightness of spaces that you showed wouldn't be as much of a challenge for people who are a lot smaller. They're still wondering if there's any light because if these people are, millions of 4 years ago, are going into these caves deliberately. How are they illuminating? How are they finding their way back? What are these bones doing there? Because maybe it reconstructs the size, but reconstructing.
That is one of the reasons that they're trying to get a good handle on the surface above the site, where it is relative to the surface, and to look at the geology of that to see whether or not there were portions that were open before that are not open at this point, where multiple routes might have been. As I said, there are lots of different routes throughout the system, and so there's a possibility maybe it was closer to an entrance. Typically, you'll have like sort of a twilight zone that animals, they don't really inhabit caves too deeply past the point where there's light. One of the old cavers, his glib hypothesis was that that these were prehistoric cavers, but in the evolution of caving, we've gotten better at getting back out, which was rather cute. Yes.
So I'm wondering what kind of world these creatures, people, were living in. From your pictures, it looks like it's currently being used as pasture land. Was this environment, a forest, a grassland?
A lot of the landscape would have been actually somewhat similar. Depending on the age, of course, of the site, as you're moving into the Pliocene, you have a aridification, sort of a drying. You have a retraction of woody areas, and you have this sort of mosaic savanna, which is some trees and grasslands. And that's actually one of the things that's related to a lot of ideas regarding the origins of humans is tied into this landscape, where you have moving from more forested environments, that the ability to exploit a niche where being able to stand up and over the grass is one idea. They still retain a lot of the very early guys, the Australopithecines. They still retain in their anatomy aspects that would have been advantageous for climbing and clambering. So you do have the ability to still get up into the trees and away from some of these predators. However, that doesn't help you much with a leopard, as we've seen in a number of cases with the fossils. But in a lot of respects, it would have been fairly similar. Mm-hmm.
So were there speleothems in there,
mm-hmm.
kind of formations that?
Yes, and that's how we're hoping. That's how we're hoping to date. So we part of it was okay. So the speleothems. So they're just the long. And we have them of varying sizes, and it's still an active cave system, so they're still actively growing by accretion. They're hoping to get actually under the puzzle box. There appears to be a cavity or a recess that's deeper under there, and so they're hoping to be able to then date those. Again, part of this was just being able to get someone who had the proper credentials and also could, get to the site has been an issue. And that's sort of brought to the forefront that in a lot of ways, with early career scientists, it's actually going to be a lot easier probably to train the scientists to cave than it is to bring the cavers up to speed although they have been training the cavers in faunal osteology and just sort of like basic, this is hominid, this is not, but don't touch any of them. Just in case, but there's a great need to just train more scientists to go into these areas. There's a lot of areas of that we just don't know a lot about, just because the scientists that could can't get into those areas. The people that would study it just can't get there. All over the world. Caves. There's. I just went to a fantastic lecture on the Kasker painted caves off the coast in France, where the only entrance to the cave was underwater, and so you had to dive. And so, one of the archaeologists there who studied, you know, the painted caves. He actually trained in cave diving. He was like in his 70s or something, and he trained in cave diving and he got certified so that he could study it, because he was like, well, you know, I got to do it. You know, no one else is going to do it. And so I think that that's an ethic that, unfortunately, you see so many scientists, they get, you know, you get so specialized, and so much of your life is taken up by you know, the grad school, that it's only people like in primatology and field primatology or something and some of these digs, that if you're constantly out in the landscape, that you'll have that kind of hardiness, whereas a lot of other scientists are getting soft. That was actually part of my calculation when I saw the call go out on social media. I was like, okay, how many people have the expertise and the fitness level and don't have the office spread going on that a lot of scientists have. Like, and so most of the applicants actually, as it turned out, were females, just because we just also just tend to be smaller. Yes?
Are you doing any DNA analysis?
This is probably well outside the ability to extract any kind of genetic material, you know, that said, we're always making advances, and there's always outside cases that just when you think that you wouldn't be able to have something, there's the freak circumstance where somehow something was preserved, and you'll have like you know, arteries and T-Rex and stuff that you wouldn't possibly have thought that would be something. So probably not, but wouldn't that be nice?
I saw one from 400,000 years ago.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah. This is quite a bit. And it's, you know, it's a rough environment, and that also is going to take a toll on DNA even younger. Yes? Okay, I'm glad you asked that. That was a fabulous segue, and that's a fabulous hat. Sorry, that just like suddenly was, that just suddenly was right in my field. No, I love that, actually. Like, I love pink and I love sparkles. I was actually teased mercilessly about that, because I wore sparkles when I went in the cave. But to answer your question, we have the National Geographic Explorer blog. There's actually a mini blog on Rising Star Expedition, that follows you. They'll have periodic updates. You can follow John Hawk's paleoanthropology blog. He blogs about other aspects of paleoanthropology, but he also keeps up to date with Rising Star. Both Lee and Both Lee Berger and John Hawks have Twitter accounts that they will that they update. I have been posting stuff as it comes available on Twitter as well. I'm hoping to send in May with the workshop and everything, sort of send dispatches back from the field, such as it were, because I think that the biggest thing that we have an ability to do here is with the transparency is to not just change how our science is done within our field, but you do have the problems that public at large doesn't have a very good idea of how science happens, that it's sort of, you know, science goes, you know, bones go in, science happens, and then, you know, articles come out the other end, and people, you know, may or may not know what the articles even mean. But if you don't have a proper appreciation of all the stuff that's going on behind this curtain, then you really can't ask people to, you know, people don't know how long does it take to do things. What are the reasonable things that we can expect to even find from this? How are hypotheses, you know, how are they made? How are they tested? We don't prove anything. We only support things. You know, everything is a process of constantly battering those and trying to falsify that. There's no really good understanding of that, and so I think that if we're able to continue sort of the blogging dissemination process so that people have an idea of how these fossils are being described and how they're being studied and our thought processes as we're looking at this, I think they'll have a better appreciation of what comes out the other end.
I want to thank you for coming and sharing your experiences with us.
Oh, thank you. So is that a standing ovation?
If you want to take a closer look at some of the
yeah.
There, and if you want to help, put the chair.